Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan had an unusual relationship, a special relationship, their joint biographer calls it.
It was closer ideologically and warmer personally than any relationship between any other British Prime Minister and any other American president.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you for the summit. Thank you for your presidency. Thank you for your testament of belief. And God bless America.
Mrs. Thatcher's longtime press secretary describes the relationship this way.
I think they were political soulmates, and that explains the closeness.
Thatcher and Reagan met years before either of them came to power. They spent hours discussing their shared vision.
It was two people saying, if only we can get there, this is what we will do.
And they did. Imagine a British Prime Minister speaking for an American president.
Margaret Thatcher would say, speaking for both of them, Ron and I think.
Thatcher altered Reagan's sentimental view of Ireland.
He gave her more support in dealing with terrorism in Northern Ireland than any previous American president had given any British Prime Minister.
She convinced Reagan that Mikhail Gorbachev was a Soviet leader they could do business with.
She phoned Reagan and said, I have just met this new leader of the Soviet Union. He is unlike any other leader of the Soviet Union.
But she never quite persuaded the American president to share her alarm over the US deficit.
It went against her grain that such a huge debt was being piled up.
The big payoff for the British came when Reagan backed Thatcher in the 1982 Falklands War with Argentina.
He knew that if he didn't back her and she lost, she would be out of power. And so at every point, he didn't let her down.
There were difficulties too. It wasn't so easy for Reagan to get Thatcher to agree to allow the 1986 US raid on Libya to be launched from British bases.
There was a very difficult passage over the bombing of Tripoli, where Mrs. Thatcher sucked her teeth very hard and long for a day with the international lawyers to try to make sure it could be squared with international law.
The 1983 US invasion of Grenada gave her fits.
Mrs. Thatcher was heard to expostulate, not once but many times, how could he do it without telling the Queen, i.e. without telling me, so that I could inform the head of the Commonwealth.
She let the President know it.
She really did give him an ear-bashing over that.
Thatcher was horrified when Reagan tried to make a nuclear disarmament deal with Gorbachev at Reykjavik in Iceland in 1986.
Mrs. Thatcher fumed for a very long time over this man in the White House, fancy wanting to give up nuclear weapons. Doesn't he realize that this technology can't be disinvented?
She did exactly what you would have expected.
We had to go across the Atlantic, I accompanied her, in order to wash his head.
She did exactly what you would have expected.
She turned American policy quite round, without actually saying that she was disagreeing with Reykjavik.
It was easy to satirize the relationship between Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan. But no one doubted that it was based on deep affection and genuine respect.
Prime Minister, the entire world salutes you and your gallant people and gallant nation.
They came to epitomize what has been called the golden age of conservatism, an age where their policies changed the map of the world, and their common economic vision is still alive today. Nick Robertson, CNN. London.